Analysis outside of the closed doors of Bilderberg ranges from those who believe it's just a talk shop to those who believe this is global elites meeting to carve up the world. Joining us now from Montreal to help us assess just what to make of these private meetings is Andrew Gavin Marshall from the Center for Research in Globalization. Thanks so much for being with us, Andrew. Now, the latest kind of mainstream excuse for Bilderberg is that these days the media is so invasive that it's really important that leaders of the world and of industry can get together and talk about things without being quoted. Is that valid, fair, unfair? How do you read that?
Well, it's pretty unfair. The media has, by and large, been a failure. So to say that the media is too invasive is frankly absurd. And the idea that you shouldn't have an open discussion among supposedly democratic leaders of supposedly democratic countries, where they should be able to go and meet with industrialists and bankers and queens and kings and talk in secret without anybody knowing, that's not democracy, that's oligarchy. So the idea that that meeting should remain private and that the media should not document these meetings or cover them is frankly saying that we shouldn't have democracy. So if you believe that argument, then you don't believe in democracy.
Okay. Along those lines, some would argue that, you know, no one there is making a law that's going to go into effect. These people have to go back to their countries and go through a democratic process, and that this is a talk shop. Do you have evidence to refute that?
Well, the former NATO Secretary General Willy Claes, last year in 2010, told Belgian radio that, and he attended several Bilderberg meetings because every NATO Secretary General does, he said that at each meeting they are given a sort of a piece of paper, a document, that's essentially a blueprint for basic policies and ideas that they are expected to implement in their respective countries and their respective institutions. So it is a talk shop in a sense that it brings together elites from North America and Western Europe, but it's about establishing consensus and coordinating policies. So it's not that there's somebody at Bilderberg, like, for example, a president saying, this is the way it is, and this is what you have to do. It's that they debate, they discuss, they even disagree, but the aim is to essentially set a consensus and to coordinate their policies for the NATO countries. And then they are expected to go home and implement these coordinations over the years. And there are certain decisions that are made at Bilderberg conferences in regards to war. For example, in 2002, the Bilderberg meeting concluded that there will not be an Iraq war in 2002. It'll be in March of 2003. And sure enough, that's what took place. They also select the heads of the IMF and World Bank and World Trade Organization. So that's one key decision that we'll see in this upcoming meeting.
But how is that known? How is that discovered? Are these from official documents that we find that Bilderberg was calling for these leaders? How is it known?
Well, there's been several leaks that have come out. Some investigative journalists have sources inside the Bilderberg meetings, and they've been proven to be correct. So say, for example, after one meeting, they say, this is the person who's going to be selected as the head of the World Bank. And as far as we know, it's idle speculation until, of course, they are selected as head of the World Bank. And generally, up-and-coming politicians will go to Bilderberg meetings. We don't know that they are selected to become, say, a president or a prime minister. For example, essentially every Canadian prime minister has attended a Bilderberg meeting before becoming prime minister. Now, does that mean that they are selected to be prime minister at the Bilderberg meeting? Not necessarily, but it certainly doesn't hurt their career.
Okay.
And so there's minutes that are also released, declassified documents, for example, from the 1955 meeting, the second meeting, they discussed a European currency, they discussed a European Union, and in 2009 the chairman of the Bilderberg conference, Etienne Davignon, told European media that in fact the euro was discussed and debated at the Bilderberg conference.
And those are kind of some of the most famous examples you cited. So my question to you, is there evidence that officials are breaking the law, for example, in their own countries? In the U.S., under the Logan Act, it is illegal for a U.S. citizen to negotiate with a foreign national, with a foreign nation, rather, on the USA's behalf. Is there any indication that that's going on?
Well, absolutely. I mean, that's the nature of the meeting itself. And I believe there have actually been some officials who have been charged with violating the Logan Act by attending Bilderberg meetings. But even in that eventuality, they end up just paying a fee which is ultimately coming out of public coffers. So by violating the law, they end up paying, the taxpayer ends up paying for their illegalities. And so there's nothing really being done about it. Questions of legality, I think, are secondary to questions of right and wrong.
Okay. Really quickly, just to clarify, are you saying that taxpayers foot the bill for these officials to go here?
Well, taxpayers foot the bill for whatever country the meeting is hosted in. But if somebody is charged in violation of the Logan Act in the U.S., for example, that fee would be paid by taxpayers.
Got it. And then really quickly, I want to find out, there are some reports that there is more mainstream media attention being paid to this on the ground there this year. Our reporter that was there said she really hasn't seen that too much yet, aside from some Swiss press. But I'm curious what your take is on that, and if you think this is a sign, if you do believe there's more mainstream media attention, that people are beginning to believe and see this as more of an important political event.
Well, the very fact that I'm talking to you is evidence of that right now. There is increased media attention on these events, and that's very important, and that needs to continue and accelerate. And frankly, there hasn't been enough for decades in the past, to the point where members of the Bilderberg conferences were able to deny its existence altogether. And last year, for the first time, the Bilderberg group actually created an official website admitting their existence and posting membership, steering committee information, conference information. Very little information, but nonetheless, they have an official website, and that's sort of an attempt to try to mitigate this increased media coverage, which should continue to increase. So I'm hoping that this year's conference, that will be the trend.
Well, we are certainly covering it here. We appreciate you for your insight. Who knows, maybe in the years to come, you will be inside Bilderberg and see exactly what's going on if it does, in fact, open up a little bit more. That was Andrew Gavin Marshall from the Center for Research on Globalization.